Good evening. Great to see you here. Welcome to Calvary Baptist Church. Let's go ahead and get started. Let's come on in here, find our seats. And if you're able to, stand with me and let's take our hymnals and turn to 341. 341. We're going to start out this evening singing Victory in Jesus. Let's lift it up on the first verse now. I heard an old story.
I heard an old story. How a Savior came from glory. How he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sin and won the victory.
Amen. Sing it out.
Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his redeeming blood.
Praise God, he loved me, yeah.
I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing.
Amen. On that second, now I heard about his healing.
I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame to walk again and cause the blind to.
Amen.
And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory.
Amen. Lift it up.
Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior.
Says he bought me, saw me with his redeeming blood. Whenever we say praise God there, just be honest here. Who did say praise God as loud as they could? All right, there's like, man, 10 of y'all. All right. So now this time when we sing it, who is going to participate with us? And they're going to say praise God as loud as they can. Pretend like it's junior church if you need to. All right. Nothing wrong with praising God. Let's lift it up here on that last verse. Now I heard about a mansion he's built for me in glory.
I heard about his mansion he has built for me in glory. And I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal.
About the angels singing. Sing it out here. The old redemption story.
Old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory.
Amen. Sing it out.
Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and he bought me with his reason.
Sing it out. Praise God, he loved me, yeah.
I knew him and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood.
Praise God. Good singing. Good singing. You can be seated. And tonight we have here with us the West Coast Baptist Bible College group singing for us. So if y'all would come up and sing. Whoa, there. Boy, that happened. All right. They're going to sing about three songs for us.
Aiden So I'll bless his name and his mercies anew every day. With all of my heart, soul, and strength I will say,
God is worthy, worthy of praise. Before the foundation of earth was laid, God was worthy of praise. When he spoke the word and the world was framed, God was worthy of praise. Through the ages, true and changeless, with all nations I proclaim, God is worthy, worthy of praise, worthy of glory. So I'll bless his name and his mercies anew every day. With all of my heart, soul, and strength I will say, God is worthy, worthy of praise. When Calvary's blood made atonement for sin, God was worthy of praise. When the tomb was empty and death could not win, God was worthy of praise. I will glory, so I'll bless his name and his mercies anew every day. With all of my heart, soul, and strength I will say, God is worthy, worthy of praise.
Omnipotent and holy, he reigns upon his throne. Yet his great unending love claims me as his own.
my God, and I love him. That's my Jesus, he died for me. For all the world to hear, I'll say it loud and clear, that's my God.
That's my God. Some
say he's nothing more than a fairy tale. He's just a myth or legend. His presence is not real.
His word is not correct politically.
mock his name defiantly.
Oh, but time has never changed the changeless one. Their lies cannot disprove the existence of God's Son. Though some may be content to just sit by,
I for one must stand and testify. That's my God, and I love Him. That's my Jesus, He died for me. For all the world to hear, I'll say it loud and clear, that's my God. That's my God, and I love Him. That's my Jesus, He died for me. For all the world to hear, I'll say my God, that's my God.
The cross I stand, trouble torn and trembling hand, knowing all that I have done, do I dare to even come? Near the cross I fall, no more strength to deserve to be near the cross at all. In the shadow of the cross, humbly I surrender all. Lord, may I be ever lost in the shadow of the
cross, I pray.
Near the cross, I pray.
Draw me nearer every day.
Draw me nearer every day. Bring His pain before my eyes. May I not forget the price. Near the cross, I plead.
Near the cross, I plead.
No more fighting, I concede.
No more fighting, I.
Though my heart is full of fear, bringing all that I hold dear, lay it down and set it free. In the shadow of the cross, humbly I surrender all. Lord, may I be ever lost.
deserve to be near the cross at all.
What an amazing start to this evening service. Praise God for that. Good singing right there. Too bad Pastor and his family is not able to hear it. They're gone on their trip. He said vacation. I don't know if you can, I don't consider bicycling much of a vacation, but to each their own on what that is. But let's be praying for Pastor and his family as they'll be bicycling across the state. They're going to go from, I don't know, I say across the state, not this way, not long ways, but, you know, up and down. Nobody loves bicycles, at least I don't. When I see bicycles, I'm like, 10 points, right, you know, when I'm driving. See, Brian's shaking his head. Yes, bicycles stay off the road, but, you know, bicycles get no love, so we'll be praying for them, you know, traveling, that no accidents happen to anybody there, so let's be praying for that, and they'll get back safely. They'll have a good time there. And then also, coming up, I forgot to announce it in my Sunday school class, because I'm a slacker, but Brother Martins, he was responsible. I try to learn from the best here. We will be having our class activity on June 11th. Both the classes are combining. We're going to go bowling. They're at the bowling alley at 4 o'clock, so meet up there. We'll have a good time. So for about 2 hours there, I think last time we bowled 2 games, so please come. We had a good time last time we bowled. Competition, this church is very competitive, and I didn't realize that, so we went bowling. So it was great. I enjoy it. I enjoy the good razzing of each other. And so please come this time, June 11th. That's this Saturday from 4 to 6 p.m. Don't forget about the Father's Day Fish Fry. That is the after the evening service about at 7:30. If you haven't ever had some of the fish that Pastor has fried up before, you're missing out. You come, try it. Even if you don't like fish, you're like, I'm not a fish person, just try at least one piece. Just like I tell my boys, so try it. I guarantee you will like it. And also, on the same day, we're kicking off the Missions Conference on June 19th as well. June 19th through the 22nd, we'll be having our Missions Conference. And I ask you to be in prayer for that, Lord. And what the Lord will lay on your heart and just... If he asks you to give something to missions, just do it. If you say that's above what I can give, if God's told you to do it, he will provide a way. He's told you to do something, so you just obey. It's just that easy. It's clear cut. You just obey, right? You're like, that's difficult to do. Well, you just do it, right? You have the confidence to do it. And like I said before, behind the window squares we got back there in the fellowship hall, we have all of our missionaries that we sponsor there, and they send letters back, and they'll post them back there. Take some time to stop and read those. It will bless your heart. It'll really bless your heart to see what the money that you're giving goes to. Being able to buy, when the Garcias talked about, they're getting to be put in a baptistry down there in Venezuela, and that 4 people have already got saved this year. Man, that just excited me. I was just like, I'm ready for the missions conference now. I'm ready to hear it on it now. But let's be in prayer for that. June 19th through the 22nd. And then also, kids, don't forget, July 18th through the 22nd will be the kids' camp there at the Royal Sea Ranch. I always enjoy when the kids get back and their stories that they tell. I know when I was growing up and going to kids' camp, I always enjoyed having stories. The crazy ones, you know, you have to really get involved with the kids to let them open up and tell you the ones of that happened late at night. But that's fun. They always have fun stories of what happens there. And then they're singing when they get back. They always practice their singing. They always come back. The past couple of years, they've won some of the competition singing they do down there, and they do such a good job. They do such a good job, so you won't want to miss out on that, but that is July 18th through the 22nd. And at this time, we'll go ahead and take up our tithes and offering. We'll go ahead and have the ushers come forth. And if you were given a visitor's card, if you'll fill that out and please put that in the offering plate as that passes by, we'll sure appreciate that. And I'll go ahead and pray for the offering now. Lord, we thank you so much for all that you do for us, Lord. We thank you for the great singing that we've got to hear tonight, Lord. It's just a joy to be able to praise your name, Lord, and what you have done for us. Lord, I pray that you'll be with us and guide us. I pray that you'll be with Pastor and his family as they're traveling, Lord. I pray that you'll keep them safe on their trip, Lord, and nothing will come of them. No accidents will happen, Lord, and they'll have a good time there, Lord, and you'll bring them back safe and sound to us. Also pray, Lord, for tonight for the offering, that you'll bless the gift and the giver, and in your name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Amen. If you recognize that song, it was simply entitled, People Need the Lord. And that's why you're having a missions conference in a couple of weeks. That's why West Coast Baptist College exists, to send forth laborers into the harvest. That's why you have the opportunity to take tracts out and to invite friends and family and co-workers to this place, because people need the Lord. Well, it's so good to be with you tonight here at Calvary Baptist. And my name is Daniel Blim. I'm the Dean of Men there at West Coast Baptist College, and I have the privilege of being able to travel around with this group this summer and to be able to just... Well, I guess be their adult for them. That's what I get to do. And I get to be their chauffeur, and I get to make sure that they're, you know, doing right and stuff like that. But it is a privilege to be with you tonight. And I love your pastor. Love your pastor's wife. He and I go way back. We were in college at the same time together. And I used to work on staff just south of here in Altus, Oklahoma. And so we used to do a lot of the camp activities together. We used to do a college and career retreat activity and things. And so love the Corleys. Love what God is doing in and through them. But behold it, this is my second time ever being at the church, and pretty crazy when you think about that. But it is a privilege to be with you tonight. And as I mentioned a moment ago, we brought the college kids, and you've already enjoyed the singing. They're going to come and sing a few more songs in just a moment. But we also brought some information about the college. For those of you that maybe don't know about the ministry of West Coast Baptist College there in Lancaster, California. And some people ask, well, where is Lancaster, California? And we are just about an hour to the northeast of Los Angeles. So if you think of Southern California, you think of Los Angeles, we're about an hour to the northeast. In fact, we're just on the other side of the San Andreas Fault Line. Has anybody ever heard of the San Andreas Fault Line? Should California ever break off and fall into the ocean, we will be on the correct side, and we will get the oceanfront property. That's where we are located at. But no, it's a beautiful place. It is a high desert area, but literally the campus and the church is an oasis in the desert, and God is doing some great things there. In fact, we just had our 26th year of ministry and saw just our 3,000th graduate walk across the platform and now serving the Lord all over the world as Christian teachers and ministry workers. And God had, the Lord Jesus Christ had a prayer while he was here, and that was that the fields are wide unto harvest, but the laborers are few. And so what are we to do? We're to pray, therefore, that the Lord of the harvest, that he would send forth laborers. And that's what we are existing for, is to help train ministers and help train Christian workers. And so if we can be a help to you in any way, please let us know. I would encourage you to get around and get to know the young people tonight that are singing for you. And they will bless your heart as you just kind of get to know them and hear their testimonies and maybe ask them questions about their college ministry or their college time or what they're learning. And I know that they would love to be able to get to meet you. And if for no other reason, you ought to get to know them tonight, because you're going to spend eternity with them. So you might as well get to know them now. And that way you can know if you want your mansion close to theirs or not, right? I'm just kidding. But we do also have some books on the back table, and we do travel with some stuff just to be able to offer some opportunities for you to get some good music and some good Christian material into your homes and into your families. And so we've got several of those things on the back table. We've got the brand new CD just came out with the group you heard tonight or are hearing tonight, as well as our college choir, college ensemble, simply on this new CD, The Only Worthy King, as well as some previous CDs back there on the back table. We have several devotional books. We've got two devotional books for you ladies. We've got a book back there for just anybody in general, and that's the one I'm holding in my hand, is a walk through the book of Luke, and it's simply entitled Disciple. It's just a one-page devotional, and it just kind of walks through the book of Luke and some great principles, some great thoughts, and just a supplement to your own personal Bible reading, maybe to help you kind of get out of a rut maybe, or just to get some consistency, or maybe this might be a great gift idea for somebody. And I would encourage you to grab that one on the back table, as well as maybe one of the ladies' devotionals. We also have a brand new book by our pastor's wife, and it is written just to kind of just encourage us all to get back to being hospitable one towards another. And that's the title here, is Heartfelt Hospitality. It's a cookbook, but the opening pages really talk about getting back to the heart of just being hospitable, being kind one towards another. How many of you are old enough to remember, and maybe I'm crossing a line here, how many of you are old enough to remember when neighbors actually used to talk to each other? Remember that? Remember when they actually like would pull in the driveway and get out and go across the street and talk to somebody instead of just shutting the garage door and hurry before they know that we're home, you know, kind of thing? Well, we have lost that in our culture, and I believe we're starting to lose even the battle of seeing people that need the Lord because we're not open to relationships with one another. And this book just kind of really just kind of hits the heart on it. And specifically, maybe it talks to the ladies by way of ladies. You don't have to have the nicest meal to be hospitable. You don't have to have the biggest house on the block to just have people over. In fact, and again, I don't want to cross the line, you could even have like paper plates and pizza and it'd be all right. And people are going to be just fine with that because here's what's happening. They're going to let down their guard. They're going to get to know you and they're going to get to see what a Christian's really like. And they may never step foot in a church service, but they'll step foot into your living room and you'll have the opportunity to present the gospel to them. And so that's just kind of what this cookbook kind of talks about in the opening chapters, as well as some wonderful recipes. And then the other book I just wanted to highlight for you as I kind of looked at the congregation tonight is a book that was written several years ago by our executive vice president, Dr. Mark Rasmussen. He's been in Christian education now, I believe, over 40 years now, and he has worked in Christian education, specifically at the college level, for that long. And he wrote this book a couple years ago to teachers, and but I believe the principles apply to all of us that have influence. And I'm looking out, and the reason I picked this book tonight is I'm looking out at a lot of young people in the congregation. And us older folks, we are training them, we are teaching them, we are impacting or influencing them right now. And so the question is, how are we doing? How are we doing by transitioning or transferring faith to them? And this particular book I picked up is simply entitled 101 Tips for Teaching. And this is, as it says on the bottom, practical advice for everyone who imparts truth. So whether you're a parent, whether you're a grandparent, whether you're one of the Sunday school teachers, or whether you're just a stay-at-home mom, but you have some influence in the hearts and lives of somebody else, I would challenge you to just to pick this up, to thumb through it, and to just get some ideas on how you can impact the next generation coming behind you. Because if we fail to do it, what's the saying? We're one generation away from extinction. And so I would encourage you to pass on your faith. And this is just some practical tips by way of how you can be an encouragement, how you can love on people, how you can see past the moment of disobedience and see what they can be. And so this is a great book. Normally sells for $12, but I'm going to do a Calvary Baptist special only tonight. And so you can pick this book up there for just $5 tonight. And I believe this will be a help to you and encouragement to you. But it has been so good to be with you tonight. And I was telling Pastor, and I don't know why he wanted to go bike riding either when I talked to him. But I said, man, Pastor, I was looking forward to being with you and catching up with you. But I understand it's more important for you to spend time with your family and a church. I just want to say thank you for letting your pastor be able to get away and do that. And I would encourage you to continue to love on your pastor and his dear family. You have a treasure in them. And so as bummed as I am not to be able to see him, I'm excited to be able to hear the speaker tonight, and I'll let them introduce him. But I'm excited to hear Brother Osteen, who had a pivotal point in my own life in training and teaching me. And so I know I'm looking forward to that, Brother Osteen. But I'm going to have the college students come again, and they're going to prepare to sing a couple more songs for you. And so I trust that you'll tune in. Whatever it was that you were doing earlier, do it again, because they sounded really good. So if you were smiling at them, smile again. If you were amening, amen again. If you were sleeping, whatever it was you were doing, do it again, because they sounded really good. But you enjoy these next couple of songs before the message this evening.
I've heard it all my life, even had it memorized, but it was only words to me. Read letters on a page, just something people say, till it brought me to my knees. Those words in John 3:16, God so loved the world, he gave his only son away to save a wretch like me, the one who needed grace to cover every stains that he no longer sees. It's amazing to believe that God
to love the world means even me.
How could he see my sin and forgive me even then? Who would pay that kind of price?
I've seen what mercy does. He found me where I was,
and he gave his life for mine. For God so loved the world, he gave his only son away, away to save a wretch like me. Me, the one who needed grace, grace to cover every stain, stains that he no longer sees. It's amazing to believe that God so loved the world means even me. Me with all my failures, me with all my shame, it's the very reason Jesus God so loved the world, he gave his only son away, a way to save a wretch like me. For God so loved the world, he gave his only son away, a way to save a wretch like me. Cover every stain, stains that he no longer sees. It's amazing to believe. It's so amazing to believe that God so loved the world means he.
Next song, I'd like to share something with you if I could. The first song we sang was called God is Worthy. And this last song has to do exactly with the same subject, God's worthiness. And so I like how we started with it and we're ending with the fact that God is worthy. And at the end of the day, all the bad things that are kind of happening, it's not, you don't have to be a genius to see it. It's pretty obvious. At the end of the day, we're all going to be on the winning side. And we're all going to be proclaiming the message that lives in light of all that we face, that God is worthy of our worship, of our praise, of our adoration. And he's worthy enough to come to church. He's worthy enough to sing about. And we get to exclaim that message the rest of eternity, that God is worthy.
Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is
Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave. He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory?
Is he worthy of this?
He is. Does the Father truly love us? He does. Does the Spirit move among us? He does. And does Jesus, our Messiah, hold forever those he loves? He does. Does our God intend to dwell again with us? He does. Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave. He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave.
From every people and tribe,
every people and tribe,
every nation and tongue,
every nation and tongue, he has made us a kingdom and priest to God to reign with the Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy of this? He is. He is. Is he worthy? Is he worthy? He is. He is. He is worthy.
Serve a worthy, worthy God. Mm. Love that. Love the singing. Love the servant's heart. You know, we were talking beforehand, and you know, they were trying to find out if there was anything that they could do to be a help. So it's great to see that for sure. And I am excited. We do have Brother Osteen with us here. He was pastor over El Reno, and then he served, I believe, at Heartland. Correct? Did you serve Heartland, brother?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Okay, want to, you know, make sure before I said something. But anyway, but yeah, and he's an evangelist, and he comes out of our sending church, Southwest Baptist, and he's been here before. It's always been a blessing, so make sure you lend your ear to him. And I believe we've got some water here for you, brother. Who got this for Brother Osteen? Okay, and did you clean this first? It's not, okay, all right, because pastor has one, you know, I just want to make sure that it was washed before we gave it to you, so you're in good.
I'm glad you did give it to me, brother.
I'm y'all glad to be in the house of God tonight. Thank you for allowing Connie and I to have the privilege of being here with you. We appreciate Brother and Sister Corley and their faithfulness and love to the Lord, and thank you. West Coast Baptist, Brother Blim, what a blessing y'all are being tonight. Wasn't that great? Amen. They sang for the Lord, and they lifted up our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Any saved people in here tonight, say amen if you're saved. And if you're not, you need to get on in, amen, and get saved tonight. This is a good time to get saved, give your heart to Jesus. June the 28th, 1970, when I received Jesus Christ, we were coming out of Louisiana. My dad was, mom or they were called to go to Canada. We were going to the mission field up in New Brunswick, Canada. And we stopped over at Bible Baptist in El Reno, where I live. And Dad preached up a storm, and God blessed. Went over to Grace Baptist Church in Oklahoma City that night, and that's the night I got saved. And so I was one of those little missionary kids handing out our missionary cards, asking everybody to support the Osteens. Amen? And what a blessing. 50 years now, last year, celebrated 50 years up in Canada that the church, we didn't get to go, but they celebrated 50 years of First Bible Baptist Church in Quispamsis, New Brunswick. Now, you wouldn't believe it, I spent 5 years up in Canada. Can you imagine a Louisiana man from North Louisiana and his wife, a South Louisiana Cajun, going up to the state maritime province of Canada? I mean, people were coming out of the woodwork just to hear my dad preach. They liked that southern drawl, amen? And, wow, I tell you what, he'd preach, people get saved, and I would tell you, I'm excited. So I'm still excited about missions. So get here in the missions conference and be faithful. Let God use you. And we support missions, and we're thankful for the church that support us. And what a blessing to be able to live for God and serve the Lord. Amen? Amen. And I'm just glad to be here. 1 Samuel chapter number 8. Let's find our place there. And I'm thinking of the theme about the king, about the worthy Savior that we serve. This message is going to dovetail right along. How many of y'all believe God knows what we need? Amen? Amen. Let's stand for the reading of the Word of God. 1 Samuel chapter number 8. If you're able to stand. And let's let the Lord speak to our hearts tonight and praise His name. I'm supposed to be back next Wednesday. Now, if I give a dud here, y'all just tell the preacher that Brother Blim's going to come back and preach or something, amen? But amen. He's one of the rowdy guys I taught, I think.
Yes, sir.
Is that right? Okay, I'm trying to think back, amen? I don't know, I've been through all kinds of stuff. Now, he was a good student, and we've been through a lot of stuff ourselves. I've been through a kidney donation and went through cancer, went through COVID, and I've got Connie, amen? So all four things. I need help in prayer, amen? And so she prays for me all the time. She says, you sure do need it, amen? 1 Samuel chapter 8, the Bible says in verse number 1, and it came to pass when Samuel was old that he had made his sons judges over Israel. Now the name of the firstborn was Joel, and the name of his second Abiah, and they were judges in Beersheba. And his sons walked not in his ways, but turned aside after lucre, and took bribes and perverted judgment. Then all the elders of Israel gathered themselves together, and came to Samuel unto Ramah, and said unto him, behold, thou art old, thy sons walk not in thy ways. Now make us a king to judge us like all the nations. Now I want you to notice that phrase, like all the nations. But the thing displeased Samuel, when they said, give us a king to judge us. And Samuel prayed unto the Lord. And the Lord said unto Samuel, hearken unto the voice of the people and all that they say unto thee. For they have not rejected thee, but they have rejected me, that I should not reign over them. According to all the works which they have done since the day that I brought them up out of Egypt, even unto this day, wherewith they have forsaken me and served other gods, and so do they also unto thee. Now therefore hearken unto their voice, howbeit yet protest solemnly unto them, and show them the manner of the king that shall reign over them. Now let's jump to verse number 19. Nevertheless, the people refused to obey the voice of Samuel, and they said, nay, but we will have a king over us, that we also may be like all the nations, and that our king may judge us and go out before us and fight our battles. You'll notice there in verse 20, and you'll notice there in verse number 5, that he said, the statement, make us a king to judge us like all the nations. I want to preach a little while tonight on the cost of being like the nations. There's a cost to be like the nations. How many of y'all believe the nations they were talking about were nations that do not know God? They're idolatrous nations. They were wicked nations, oppressive nations. And so we're going to deal with this tonight. There's a price to pay for being like the world. There's a price to pay for being like the world. Lord, we ask you to help us tonight. We know that without you, we can do nothing. We come to you in the name of Jesus, thanking you for your great grace and mercy, that you died and was buried and rose again to give us eternal life. I thank you for the day you saved me, Lord, and called me into your work. I thank you for each one of these brothers and sisters in Christ tonight. And then, Lord, our sinner friends that are not saved yet, that they'll call on you before it's too late. I pray, Lord, this will be their birthday, their first time they realize they're lost in their sin, really knowing that they're going to hell and that they need a Savior. Help them to call upon you because you gave us the good news, the good tidings of the gospel. that you love us and you died for us and was buried and rose again. So I pray you'll help us, Lord, to reach the nations. But Lord, we cannot reach the nations and minister to the nations and give light to the nations if we're walking in darkness, if we're walking in rebellion. If, Lord, we are not seeking to serve you as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So help us tonight, we pray. Deal with our hearts, we ask. In your name, Jesus, amen. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. I believe we ought to pay attention. How many of you all, you may be seated. How many of y'all believe we ought to pay attention? I'm going to pay attention to these little things swimming around this water, right? Thank you, young lady. I need that. I might need that a few times when I'm preaching tonight. And thankful for the Lord's word, but we have to pay attention, don't we? Are you ready to pay attention tonight? Is your focus on the internet or what you're eating for supper tonight? Or did you come to meet with the Lord? Can we say tonight, Jesus, you're welcome here tonight? He's not outside the door knocking to get in. That's the light I'll see in church. Remember that? He's knocking, wanting to open the door. He's knocking at the door of the church, asking to be able to come in. And the Lord's the greatest gentleman you'll ever meet. He's not going to push himself on you. He wants you to want him. Because when you love God, it's that you desire to love him. And you want to love him. Amen? And you want to serve. So we ought to pay attention. But too many times we're not paying attention to our lives and where we're serving God, and if we're serving God, and we're waiting, well, when I get older, when I get this, or get more educated, when I learn more, then I'll really get all in on Jesus and what he asked for me. But we better get all in on now. We better pay attention now. Right. Don't do like that country boy. He went up to his wife and said, honey, how you doing? She said, I'm doing good, but yeah, she says, it's the middle of the summer, and I'd like to have some of them flowers. She said, what do you mean? So Valentine's gone, but I love them flowers. And he said, well, I can take care of that. He said, I'll go to the Walmart and get you some flowers. And so he goes over there, and he finds the flower section, and he gets her, and it's a flower, and he comes home, and he said, honey, I'm home. And she said, oh, I'm so glad, I'm so happy. And what kind of flowers did you get me? He said, I got you some self-rising flowers so you can make me some biscuits. How many of y'all believe he woke up in the hospital 2 days later? That's not paying attention, was it? Not paying attention. And if we don't pay attention to the Word of God, we're not going to see God work in our lives. So I want you to notice this passage of Scripture real carefully. You'll look there in verse number 5. It says, and said unto him, behold, thou art old, and thy sons walk not in thy ways. Now make us a king to judge us like all the nations. And so here they are, the children of Israel had been in rebellion. And their rebellion was their hallmark. They continued to rebel against God. And there was always a remnant of them that believed the Lord and served the Lord. And we thank God for that. But notice they had an attitude here of rejecting God's kingly presence. Now, I know Jesus Christ came as a prophet. Aren't you glad of that? And he's operating as a priest today, and we can go straight to him, amen, in prayer. And he's coming back as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. But, friend, I'm going to tell you right now, he is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And we need to bow before his presence today and yield our hearts to him. And listen, friend, understand that Jesus died for you and was buried and rose again for us, so that he can reign in our life. Here we find the children of Israel were not wanting the things of God. They wanted to live after the nations. I mean, here is a point. After the time of the judges, Samuel was probably actually the last judge. And you're going to find something about these boys in just a few moments. You'll see here it was coming to the top. It was festering to the top. That rebellion of do my own thing and to live like I want to live and do that which is right in my own eyes is getting ready to really be exposed right here at this time of the history of Israel. You'll notice that the former generations who had judges appointed by God to rule them still live with that motto, they did that which was right in their own eyes. And if you and I are living that way, if we're in rebellion as God's people, then we're not yielding to the lordship of Jesus Christ. And we find here that they were acting that way. The problem with this is that our natural eyes are connected to our wicked hearts, and we are biased toward, our rebellion and what we think is right and relative to our feelings and not the facts of the Word of God. If we're not careful, we can let a heart that's not right with God rule over us, and if we do that, then we're not going to be that which we ought to be in praising God and serving God. Israel forgot about this intimate covenant relationship that they promised to keep with God. God chose Israel out of the nations to be his peculiar, his special people. He sanctified them. He set them apart. He said, you're mine, you're holy unto me. And the idolatrous nations were not to be sought after, mimicked, copied, or desired. But when unyielded to God, man will always be yielded to the world. And we find that they were living that way. You see, for the Christian, the world is not to be copied. It is to be overcome. According to John 16, verse 33. God's relationship with Israel was as a husband married to a wife. And she constantly was brought back to him from being with many lovers. And she kept going to this adultery, spiritual adultery with the idolatrous nation. And he kept bringing her back. And he kept loving her. Israel committed this adultery with the world and wondered why God was not giving them what they wanted. Well, it was time to give them a king like the world, but it would be a chastening of them. They rejected God's leadership and wanted to be like all the other nations. I mean, it got so low with their own way that even the great Samuel, watch this. Look at verse number 1. He made his sons judges. Are you listening? He made his sons judges over Israel. Now, what's wrong with that? Well, Samuel was already trying to pass down judging positions to his sons as kings would do. This was fleshly. This was nepotism. Now, we know nepotism, the root word nepotism, has the idea of giving favor to your nephew. And it's related now to any relation. And so he wanted to give them this favoritism. God was the only one qualified to appoint a judge. You see how it affected even Samuel? Even the great men of God and great women of God are still going to trip up time and again. Why? Because we be but flesh. But at the same time, that's not an excuse because we are not making an excuse. And I'm not making one for Samuel. But Samuel was not appointed to appoint judges. God didn't show him that. And it's proof by the ones he chose, by his own sons. And so it was a real low time in Israel. It was a conflicting time. And we find that God was trying to work in their life, but they did not listen. It got so low there. These young men were wicked and vile in their actions and attitudes. So where is Israel's dependence on God in all this? Well, it's like soured, spoiled children whining until they get their own way. God is going to chasten them by giving them what they wanted. And sometimes you can give a child what they want and they'll find out they don't want it. Like I did one time when I was a little kid. How many of y'all have ever been a little kid? Amen? And so Dad and Mom, we were over at family or friends over down in Slidell, Louisiana, back in the day. And I was just a little toddler and third of five kids. And, boy, there was little yellow and red and orange hot peppers were growing right there by the porch of this trailer house. And every time Dad looked away, I tried to reach. He looked at me, boy, get away from them things. They're hot. They'll burn you up. I didn't like anybody telling me what to do. I'm four. Three and a half or four, right? 3 years old, probably. Every now and then, Dad would look over. I was reaching for those peppers. He slapped me away. He said, boy, get away from those things. I'll burn your mouth all up. After three or four times of doing that, finally he got tired. He says, go ahead and take you a handful of them. Now, you got to know my dad. He's a North Louisiana country boy. And I thought, well, I won. I'm going to get what I want. When I got a hold of those peppers, they got a hold of me. Man, I had blisters on my lip. I was screaming and hollering, wanting something to drink. Mama come out of the house and said, Ronald Lee, what did you do that boy? He said, I just gave him what he wanted. How many of y'all believe sometimes God has to give you what you want just to teach you and I a lesson? And that's what he's getting ready to do with Israel. He's going to give them what they want, and they're going to find out that they don't want it. I've often worked with young people. And, boy, I want that girl over there. I said, you don't want her. Because when you get her, you're not going to want her after you get her. Oh, yeah, preacher, I'm going to want her. And I'm going to get her. And when he got her, he wished he wouldn't have. Because she wasn't the will of God for his life. I've seen it happen with the girls. Go, that boy, I got to have him. And a few years later, you find out he wasn't worth shooting. Now, friend, I'm going to tell you, you and I, if we don't get our eyes kept on Christ, we don't get our focus on the Lord, and we want our way, we need to listen when God says no, and he nudges us out of the way and says, don't do that. Instead of getting mad at God, by the way, our sin is first against God. Is that right? Instead of getting pouty against God, how about us just yield to his will and let him have his way? And so this attitude that would cost Israel for being like the other nations was summarized in 1 Samuel chapter 8 and verse 18 and 20. He says, "And they shall cry out in that day because of your king which ye shall have chosen you, and the Lord will not hear you in that day. Nevertheless, the people refused to obey the voice of Samuel. They said, Nay, but we will have a king over us. Nay, no, God, we want our way." By the way, when you and I do not yield to the Holy Spirit, and the Spirit of God nudges us to do something, and we say, no, you know what we just did? We quenched the Holy Ghost. When the Spirit of God is dealing with it, God's working in our life, and the world pushes us, and we say yes to the world, we've just grieved the Holy Ghost. When we're living our life for the Lord, and we're walking with God, and we're being tempted by the world, and we go into rebellion, we just resisted the Holy Ghost. And those are the moments that we get out of the will of God, and we can do just like the children of Israel did right here. And think like, we don't need a king. We don't need Jesus to tell me what to do. I've learned three verses in Sunday school, and I know it all now. Amen. I always wonder why people don't read their Bible. They must have read three or four verses, and they figure they knew the whole Bible. How about reading the Bible all the time and learning all the time? Amen. How about growing in the grace of God? How about yielding to his authority? How about keeping up with what God wants you and I to do every day? And so we see here, God wanted to be their complete spiritual kingly authority. But they did not want that. God even prophesied in Deuteronomy chapter 17 that Israel would want a king and would soon allow that to come to their heart to say, I do not want Jesus, God in my life, and I want my own king like the world. And so the Lord began to deal with them about this. Notice their obvious rejection of God there in verse number 19. And then we see this, their stubborn refusal of God's man in verse number 19. All God says through his man in the preached word and taught word of God needs to be listened to. But they wanted that world. Now remember the world, there's many definitions of the world. When I talk about the world, I could talk about the earth itself and the ground and the sky. Just the world, it's circular, it's got an orbit. Or we could talk about the Lord says, God, he loved the world, that's the people in it, the inhabitants, amen, the sinners that need a Savior. Aren't you glad that, for God so loved the world, like they sang about a while ago. But here, the worldliness that was seen in the Philistines, and who were their enemies, and they had just won a victory over in chapter number 7, they were a picture of the world, a picture of the flesh. The flesh, the world, and the devil, they were just kind of all together, they're enemies of God. And the world is a circuit of a system of evil that is anti-God. How many of y'all believe we have a system of evil that we have to live in every day? Now remember, a world's a circuit. I come up to you, when I preach out of Romans 12, 1 and 2, I talk about this, but that we ought not yield ourselves to the world. We understand that we ought to not be conformed to this world. So we're always, when the world is around us and affecting us, the world's always trying to conform us and put their thumbprint on us. At the same time, God has us on the spinning wheel, and we're the clay, and he's the potter, and he wants to mold us. And so we have to push away and resist by faith, by obeying God, and saying no to the world. I might come up to you and say, how's your world? And basically what I mean by that, and you've heard the phrase, you might say it yourself to somebody, we're talking about, well, how have things been going lately, like the last few weeks, the last month? Because we have a circuit that we walk. Are y'all with me? We have a pathway that is similar every day. It might be that we go to school or go to work. We're around those people over here and this group over here. We're at home here. We're doing things on the internet here. And we're talking to this person here. And we're reading this book here. And so what's in our world? How many of y'all believe that in a circuit of 3 or 4 weeks in our life, we've come in contact with the world? And we've come in contact with things that are anti-God. Would you agree with that? Now, we have enough problem as it is to come in contact with that and stay right with the Lord, don't we? And to yield ourselves to God and to bow before him. So we have to be tender toward God. Because not careful, we get calloused toward the things of God when we don't yield. This is where the children of Israel were. Remember, the Lord said concerning the world, Romans 12:2, be not conformed to this world. Galatians 1:4, who he said, Paul said, who gave himself for our sins that we might he might deliver us from this present world. Galatians 6:14, but God forbid that I should glory save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified unto me, and I unto the world. James 1:27 says, pure religion, undefiled before the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction, and to keep himself unspotted from the world. And he says over in 1 John chapter 2, verse 15, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. And so we have that struggle ourselves that the children of Israel had, is that we want another king. We want another authority. We want to be like the nations. That doesn't mean we can't. I was watching a video last night on YouTube about the Mennonites. And Menno Simons was their founder back in the 1600s, I think it was. And I mean, I can't, it's a German Dutch, kind of a mixture there. And they would, many of them went over to Belize. And in South America, they have a place where they just practice very strict conservative ways, what we call ultra conservatism. And their salvation message is about works anyway. And it's not really a saved by grace, but the more we don't look like everybody else, the more we believe God's going to accept us. Well, now they're getting corrupted, and a few people have got cell phones. So there's a group of them have just moved over to a place in Peru, and they bought land out in the jungle where they begin to go into the jungles and cut some of those trees down, and they're starting them another colony. And they're supposed to stay away from modern things. But they had to fly a jet to get there. It's all conflicting ideas that they have that they're doing themselves anyway. Just so they can say they're getting from this. Listen, we don't have to go to that extreme. We can live for God. Now, we don't need to hang out with the world, be companions with them. But we're going to have to be in the world but not of the world and show them that Jesus Christ is reigning in our hearts. And we're serving God here in this community. And we're loving the Lord. And we're being faithful to God. I remember my oldest sister had a little problem with rebellion, and she's in heaven now. But I remember she'd come home and, Dad, can we do this? And Dad said, no, we're not going to do this. She said, all the other kids are doing it. You know what Dad would always say? Come on now. That's the other kids. That's not you. Now, we hate to hear that. Well, we hate to hear that part. Makes us want to be more rebellious if you're not careful, because rebellion feeds on rebellion. Is that right? And we're just going to show how we can do it our way, and we can last, and we can eat them peppers and be cool about it. And it won't work, amen. It won't happen. And so let's look and see what the Lord's telling us here. The clear announcement, what they want there in verse number 19, we see they wanted no more of the judges God appointed them. But they want a king like the idolatrous nations with another sinful man in charge. Just what they need, right? Not at all. He said, well, we need to send all the godly Christians to Washington. By the time they get there in a few months, they're all going to get corrupted anyway. I'm not saying there's not some that are good. I thank God for Brother Lankford. He's a good man of God that we've elected here in our state. And very, very few states have a good man of God that's up there like him. But I'm telling you, there's going to be the effect on all of us, no matter what man it is. But we've got to make our choice that we want God to control us, not the school system. Not the government, not the world, not the flesh. Remember, we have our upward enemy, Satan. We have our out there enemy, the principalities and powers of the air. We have our outward enemy, the world, but we have our inward enemy, the flesh. And the only way we can win the victory over them is by yielding to the Lord Jesus Christ. Because we cannot fight the victory and win it ourselves. But their foolish desires were put forth. Look there in verse 20. That we also may be like all the nations. Now, what do you want to be like them? What are you talking about? Worship the same way? Wear the same clothes? Eat the same food? Go to the same places? Do all the things that they do? When you look at the other nations compared to the way Israel lived, there was an opposite thing that God had. He said, I want you different from the world. And one of the things that many people are saying today, Lord, I just want to come like I am. And I thank God for just as I am. Amen. But listen, when you come like we are, God is so good, He won't let us stay that way. He changes us. He makes us better. Amen. He makes us more like Him. And the less of Steve Osteen is better than more of Steve Osteen. The less of you is better than more of you. We need more of Jesus, amen, every day in our life. And so let's look at these areas. First of all, we find here they said they wanted to be like the nations. Look there, verse 20. They wanted to be like the nations. And so this was a casting aside of the unique relationship as a distinct, different people that are true to God. See, Israel had a problem with authority. They had an affection problem, and they had an attitude problem. They had they wanted to be their own authority and make their own king, thinking they somehow could be like the nations, and that king's going to look down on them, be such a nice king, and everything's going to go their way. They had an affection problem. Their love was in the wrong place. They should be loving God more than anyone. They had an attitude problem because they resisted against the word of God. And when we live that way, we're in a lot of trouble, my friend. And they were in trouble with God. They said they wanted to be like the nations. Why do you want to be like the nations? Tell me about it. If you and I sat there and talked with God about it, and we say, Lord, we want to be like the nations. And then you ask the question, and then he comes back with a question. He says, well, explain to me what you mean being like the nations. Now, let's stop before we get into that little question in there with God. Because I believe what we can see right now, that it's going to go nowhere. Because we're really not going to have much to say about the nations. We're not going to really be able to pick out a lot of good stuff about the nations that are idolatrous and rebellious. Matter of fact, we're not to go to the other nations to be like the nations. We're to go there to be Christ-like in front of them so they can see Jesus Christ. When we were missionaries to Canada, one of the things my dad and mom drilled in us kids when we went to school, don't go to school and try to act like you can make them Americans. We're not here to make Canadians Americans. We're here to love Canadians where they're at. And we're to do custom things they do that are not ungodly. We can eat the food that's okay, that's not ungodly. We can go play some things that are not wicked, and we can participate. That's why I loved ice hockey. That was a wonderful sport. Somebody say amen. Don't y'all even know what that is, right? When we moved back to Louisiana, I had to sell all my hockey equipment. I finally made first string my eighth grade year in a hockey team, and I'm thinking, I'm so disappointed. I had to sell my Bauer skates and everything. And bought a 10 speed. I don't know where that came up, but I bought a bike, amen. That might have helped Brother Corley tonight. I don't know. But here I am. We're coming back. We're looking up there in Canada. We had to go across the line to Calais, Maine to get Dr. Pepper, amen? I mean, to tell you, it was just different. Our goal was not to go to make them Americans. Our goal was to love them where they were at. Matter of fact, I went to school with those people, from young men from and ladies from Spain, from England, from Ireland, and from other nations. There's a lot of people, different nations in Canada, like America. And so what do you go? You go with the gospel. You go with something that's better than the nations. We go with the truth of God's love. Amen. We go with the message of salvation. Jesus died, was buried, and rose again, and can save them where they're at. And many of those people that my dad preached to, that we ministered to, and we passed gospel tracts to, that got saved, are serving God today. Why? Because we went to them and told them of a greater nation, the kingdom of God. Amen. But we're not to go to try to be like the nations. Second of all, they wanted their own king to judge them. You know what this was saying? It was saying that God was not good enough to judge his people. But they wanted a human, sinful king who would tax them heavily and take their children as servants and soldiers and confiscate their lands and rule with selfish and fearful motives. This would be a high cost of being like the nations. Now, the reason I didn't read verse 9 through verse 17, because I just want to highlight something, and basically I just summarize it. But I want you to look with me in verse number 11. Get your Bible. I want you to do something with it. And I want you to look, because I'm going to point out six times. Watch this phrase. There's a phrase that's going to pop up six times in the next few verses. Are you ready? Verse number 11. He says, he will take. That's what the king, you get a man king, he's going to take. Look at verse 13, and he will take. Verse 14, and he will take. And verse 15, and he will take. Verse 16, and he will take. And verse 17, he will take. How many of y'all believe the world's never given us anything? The nations of the world never given us anything that is lasting. All they do is take. That's what the world will do with you, young person. Will take your integrity. Will take your virginity. Will take your cleanliness. Will take your good conscience. Will take your opportunity. And will destroy your life. And how many times we as adults have looked back and saw some things that have been taken from our life. Well, the problems in America today is too many takers and not enough givers. Amen. God makes givers. You see, and he began to tell them, you know, your boys are going to be soldiers. They're going to go out there and die. When we know we have to have soldiers. But that's just the reality of a government. Is that right? But if you go back and read back in chapter 7, that God rained hail out of heaven. Well, man, I tell you, I wonder what happened the other day when our new car got hit with hail. It's at the hospital for 5 months now. Or weeks, excuse me. Getting hail damage fixed. How many of you believe hail, we call it an act of God, don't we? That's what insurance makes an excuse about. But he talked about that Ebenezer stone back there in chapter 7. I don't have time to read all that. But God won the victory over the battle against the Philistines. Wouldn't it be better if God would do it? And let God help us? Because that brings us to the next thought. They wanted a king to go before them. This was to say that we want a king to represent us on our terms before the nations. This was not to have man guide them over God's own will. Listen, God wanted them to listen to him. They refused God's authority. When was the last time you and I got each other anywhere? Spiritually. It's going to take us yielding to the Lord. Fourth of all, notice, they wanted a king so that he would fight our battles. So this was a self-serving cost of their own sons to give their lives when many of God's military victories in the past saw no Israelite dead because of God's divine intervention. Now, there's no army in the world can match what God did. There's no army that can walk around 7 times around Jericho and walls come down. There's no army of God, a people of God, that can go through a Red Sea and then cross again on dry ground across the Jordan. There is no army that can let God rain hail, storms, and thunder out of the sky and win a victory. There's no army that can take another army and give them complete blindness and confiscate their goods and send them back away and win a victory over them. Only God can do that. There's no military books can be written about that other than the Bible. Amen? So why would you want to be like the nations when God can take care of you? When God can win the victory in your life? When God can fight the battles? And by the way, this epic was coming because now the first king they chose was a man after their own heart, not after God's own heart. His name was Saul because he was bigger and he was stronger and he was taller. And nothing against tall people or big people or strong people. What do you say? Sometimes the eye can really fool us. Is that right? And when Samuel had to go aside and anoint David, where's that other boy at? He's out in the field. Well, that's the best place for him. He was out doing what he was told to do. He understood authority. Y'all with this? We paying attention? David understood he was a man after God's own heart. Now, watch this. Because notice, they were wanting all this thing about a king. But we need to jump over to 1 Samuel chapter 17. Go there real quickly. We're going to jump in the midst of the battle that he's getting ready to fight against Goliath. Well, matter of fact, we're just going to go to mainly two verses, verse 46 and 47. And you're going to hear something in the voice of David that summarizes what I'm preaching tonight and what God was warning them then about a king. And God was showing them that I can win victories that is going to be found in this one young man who was a man after God's own heart. He was going to be a shepherding king. He was going to be a sensitive king. He was going to be a serving king. He would be a stewarding king. He was going to be a selfless king. Now, other than a couple of big, bad mess-ups he made, he was a decent king. And that's the best man can do. But we're looking for King Jesus to take over, aren't we? Amen? But notice what David, as he alluded to this, as he's going toward Goliath, when the first king, Saul, was where? Hiding up in the tent, saying, you go ahead and go fight Goliath. When the king, if he was going to fight our battles for us, why wasn't he down there fighting our battles for us? Why were the soldiers, his own brothers, vindictive toward him when he came? When David showed up and he shouted for the battle. When he walked up with those Burger King and Brahms hamburgers, amen, and those cheeses and all that honey and whatever he had for those men and for his brothers, when he jumped out of the carriage, he said, "Woo! Are we putting a whoop dog on him or not?" Amen. He was shouting for the battle. That's the old saying they had in Alabama. I used to live in L.A., Lower Alabama. I was assistant principal and high school supervisor in Central Christian School. We had boys that loved Auburn, the other ones loved Alabama. And when they played football, when Alabama got ready to play Auburn, boy, that was the bedlam. That was going to be, it was worse than bedlam here in Oklahoma. I mean, it was a rival. They're all friends all week up until that time. They were enemies. I mean, I had to push them aside. They were wanting to fight each other, talking about Alabama. You ain't talking about mob team. We're going to put a whoop dog on you. Are y'all with me? They got fired up over their team. David showed up. Woo! We're winning. He looked down the valley and go, "We're not winning." Who's that loudmouth out there? His name's Goliath. But why don't somebody do something? Well, you just need to go back home. You're just a show off. What do you mean? Is there not a cause? Are y'all listening to this? David had already anointed God his king. David had already yielded to God, watch this, as the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. David was already praising God and singing unto his king. David was already yielded. He didn't need another king. He had God as his king. And so when he goes down, look at these verses. Look what he says in verse 46. He's getting ready to win the victory over Goliath. He said, "This day will the Lord deliver thee into mine hand, and I will smite thee and take thine head from thee, and I will give the carcass of the host of the Philistines this day unto the fowls of the air and to the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel." I don't need another nation. I don't need another king. I don't need to be like the world. I've already got my place set. I'm in God. I'm one of his children. I'm one of his subjects. I serve God. He's the king and he's the Lord of Israel. Look what he said in verse 47. "And all this assembly, all the people here that are of God's people shall know that the Lord saveth not with sword and spear." Watch this. "For the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands." David gained, but Goliath lost, didn't he? See, David's authority was right. David's affection was right. David's attitude was right. Now we go back to 1 Samuel chapter 7 and verse number 3. We're going to see what Samuel said about the very thing that they needed when they would yield to God as their king, and how God could give a victory in their life and God could work in their life. Because verse 3, he says of 1 Samuel 7, and he says, "And Samuel spake unto all the house of Israel, saying, If ye do return unto the Lord with all your hearts, then put away the strange gods and Ashtaroth from among you, and prepare your hearts unto the Lord, and serve him only, and he will deliver you out of the hand of the Philistines. Then the children of Israel did put away Balaam and Ashtaroth and serve the Lord only." Woo! They were living in victory. And then right after that great victory, that battle, and then God gave them a dedicated stone, the Ebenezer stone, which means the Lord helped us. And right there, jumping right into chapter 8, then they're going right back. Going right back. "We want a king." Now, how many of y'all believe we can have a revival meeting? God can work mightily. But if you're not careful, when we step out that door, we can walk right into a mess and get right back into the stuff we were already in. We've got to have some dedication. David had some dedication to God, didn't he? You know where he got it? He didn't get it among a crowd. He got it there on that side of that hill, where he got along with God. Oh, he got to that place where nobody... By the way, this altar is COVID-free. Amen. You're allowed to pray here. It's a place that's you and God. Amen. You might have all these people here, but it's just you and God. Listen, when we talk to the Lord, it's you and God, and me and God. And we can yield to the Lord. And here David showed that. And you see, Samuel spoke of that. Look there in that verse again, verse 3. He said there in chapter 7, we got to return unto the Lord with all our hearts, all your hearts. We have to give our heart. We have to quit letting everything else control our minds and our hearts. We have to say, "God, I need to get the junk out of my life. I need, Lord, forgive me of the weights and the sins that so easily beset me. Help me to run the race with patience and Lord, keep my eyes upon you, looking unto Jesus, who's the author and the finisher of our faith. Listen, then they repent. He said, then put away strange gods and Ashtaroth. These were Ashtaroth was a deity associated with sexuality and fertility, and by some people's war. I mean, it was. We can't even talk about how wicked this idolatrous religion was. It was so perverted, you can't even hardly talk about it. And he said, so get rid of that. Get that out of your life. Get those perversions that are turning you away. Get that fleshly living away and ask God to help you. He'll give you the victory. You don't need to listen to the Philistine out there that's violating God. You need to win the victory over him. And then revival will come. Notice he said, and prepare your hearts unto the Lord. This would be confessing your sins and submitting to God's will and seek the Lord. And place yourself at the feet of King Jesus. Amen. And then he said, we have to have responsibility. He said, then serve him only. Crown Jesus Christ as your king, as the King of kings and Lord of lords. I can't crown Jesus king in your life. You're going to have to do it. You're going to have to do it. You're going to have to do it. You're going to have to do it, young man. Young lady, you're going to have to say, I serve Jesus only. And when you serve the Lord, watch this, you're going to be serving people. You're going to be serving good. And listen, I preach at family conferences, and I tell the churches and the families, listen, you as a child, a rebellious child is never happy. Never. A rebellious child is never happy. Obedient children are the ones that are happy. Because they're set to do what's right. They're obedient to their authority. They're submissive to their parents. They're loving God and loving others. And God wants us there. So let me encourage you tonight. The Bible says here in verse number 4 there of chapter 7, what is that great phrase? Look what happened. He says, and the children of Israel did put away Balaam and Ashtaroth and serve the Lord only. Whew. Wouldn't it be great if we can say that about Calvary Baptist Church? That everybody in church, everybody at Southwest Baptist where I go, everybody in my family, everybody in your family, everybody in my home and in your home, we are serving God only. What a victory we have. So let me encourage you tonight, friend. As we find the world and the flesh today, we're not going to change them. It's going to take the Word of God to change them. But we're going to make the change by being the messenger, by showing them, by teaching them, by presenting the gospel to them. And that Word of God has power. We know the Philistines were a cruel and a vile and evil, idolatrous and perverted people in every way. God knew that Israel first needed a close relationship of love for them to have the fear of the Lord if they were going to survive as a people for God among the nations of the world. It is our rebellious sin nature that loves the world. And so we have to say, God, I need your help. Lord, I submit to you. I put myself on the altar of your will. I present my body a living sacrifice. If we as New Testament believers will crown Jesus King in our own hearts, then we will properly serve him in love today. We will not have to pay the high cost of rebellion. Let me tell you, I have scars because of my rebellion. I have scars of sin in my life because I wanted the world, because I wanted to be like the nations, because I had an inkling like one man in the Bible that said, he said that the Bible says that he wanted that world. You remember his name? Anybody remember him? Demas. He said he wanted to love this present world. And when we get our love for the worldly things, it can get us away from the King of Kings. So let me encourage you tonight, friend. Find grace in Christ. We will not have to pay the high cost of rebellion. Blessings of joy, even through difficult times, even through tribulations, even through hard days, we'll find the joy of the Lord is our strength. If not, listen, if we do not turn to Jesus Christ, we will turn to the world. Remember, we ought to be focused on God, faithful to God, fervent for God, fellowshipping with God. What happened with David? Well, it's like where we need to be today. We need to get our authority right. Is your authority right? It's in God, isn't it? We need to get our affection right. It's toward God. We need to get our attitude right. Right with God. Let's stand with every head bowed and every eye closed. I would ask God to help us tonight. As we have this time of music, as we bow our heads and close our eyes for a moment, I'm going to have a word of prayer. I'm going to ask you to let God have his way. Make this altar a place of